We are so delighted that you are here, and even more delighted that we have a Nuri band here to begin our service. So we want to thank Sharon Kim and a Nuri band for being here, and after that we will have a choir presentation by Union Church. And so I just hope that today is such a blessing to you. And so with that, we want to introduce Sharon Kim and a Nuri band. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, and thank you to our friends from Anoti Church for the beautiful music that was wonderfully done. Welcome to Union Church. We are so glad you are with us this morning, and we have a few announcements for you this week. In the pews, there are connection cards, which we encourage everyone to fill out and drop in the collection plates each week. This is a great way to let us know that you were here and how we may help you get connected to various ministries in the church. You can also submit prayer requests or requests to be added to our weekly highlights email. You may also connect with us online at unionpc.org and click on the Connect With Us image if you would prefer to do that with your fingertips. In case you didn't know, we have each week the printed sermon notes in the sanctuary lobby, and this is a great way to follow along with the sermon and take notes as you listen. It includes the scripture passages and sermon highlights. These also can be found on our website and in our weekly email. And if you've missed a previous week and you want to check in, of course, you can watch on live stream and check out the sermon notes from previous weeks online as well. We want to make sure that you were aware that the church office will be closed from December 24th, that's this coming Friday, through January 3rd. And it will open again on Tuesday, January 4th. And if you have an emergency, Pastor Dave is on call. We invite you to come and celebrate the birth of our precious Lord and Savior at our traditional candlelight worship service. It's going to be here in the sanctuary. We ask you to invite your friends and family to be with us in person, or you can watch online on livestream.com/UPC Los Altos. Following the service, we will gather on the patio to sing Christmas carols and enjoy hot cocoa together. Dress warmly and bring a flashlight or a headlamp, and we hope to see you there. If you're worried about the weather, we have an alternate plan. We'll meet in Bailey Hall, okay? All right, please join me as we say aloud the Bible memory verse for December, Colossians 2, 6 through 7. As you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving.
And good morning. At this time, we're going to do a call to worship as our group gets together. And please, I'll do the call and you can do the response, okay? Please stand. Please stand at this time. In the darkness of hopelessness, hate, and fear, God longs to comfort us.
Come, thou long-expected Jesus, and make a way where there seems to be no way.
As we worship and praise you, prepare our hearts to hear the voices of our prophets once more.
Come, thou long-expected Jesus, and challenge us with your truth once more.
We anticipate God's light to be born in our world and lives.
Come, thou long-expected Jesus, and deliver us again in this sacred season.
Please remain standing for our opening song together as we sing Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. On the extra verses, keep singing the melody and you'll hear a wonderful harmony from the choir this morning.
Thank you.
may be seated, and we present to you a choir cantata that we put together with some of the favorite music in our collection this year. And I'm calling it the most wonderful time of the year, because it is when we celebrate and proclaim God's message of hope, peace, love, and joy to a world, all because wrapped up in God's gift in the manger, Jesus.
Distracted at times. What is something you hope for?
I hope I can get my Christmas shopping done.
I hope there won't be any homework over Christmas break.
Hope is the expectation of something longed for. Since the day of creation, God promised a way of salvation and new life. Hope was born when Jesus came to earth. Jesus, the promised Messiah, is the hope of salvation.
Thank you. prophet in the 8th century B.C., whose name means God is my salvation.
More than 800 years before Jesus was born, Isaiah said, "The Lord himself will give you a sign."
What kind of a sign was that?
Isaiah said, "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel."
Emmanuel. This means God with us.
Yes. God came here to dwell with us.
Wow, that's such amazing love.
As part of our worship, we give back to God what he has given us. During the offering music, we invite the ushers to come forward to pass the plates to collect the offering and connection cards. Other ways that you can give include mailing a check into the church, or you may give online at unionpc.org/give.
To focus on making room for Jesus in our hearts and lives.
One day every knee will bow before Jesus in heaven and on earth.
And every tongue will acknowledge and declare that God rules heaven and earth.
How glorious that day will be when the whole world rejoices and sings praises to God who will rule the earth with truth and grace.
Your voices.
Julia, our accompanist. Thank you so much to the children who stepped in also for one of our songs. So one more round of applause. Thank you so much. And Merry Christmas.
We go up.
Can I say, when can I come up there? Can I say, oh, you're getting heavy?
If you want, yeah. That's okay.
Every year we light candles as we prepare for the coming of Christ. More and more candles, more and more light, as we watch and wait for Jesus, the light of the world. God of promise, come into our darkness. Renew your hope, your peace, your joy, your love in us, for you alone bring life out of death.
Receive God's promise of love from Psalm 36. Your steadfast love, O Lord, extends to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains. Your judgments are like the great deep. You save humans and animals alike, O Lord. How precious is your steadfast love, O Lord. All people may take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your delights. We'll light the candle of love now. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are again reminded of your love for us as we celebrate the coming of Jesus. He was your love in action for us. Lord, help us to reflect your love to the people around us this Christmas. Amen.
Amen. God is the God of love. And it's been so wonderful to sing praises to him today. We thank you so much, the choir. It's so beautiful singing his praises and singing all these Christmas songs. It is truly a wonderful time. Christmas is a time full of wonder and surprises. People singing, bells ringing, lights all shining so brightly, and special treats and fun activities, as well as fellowship with one another. We're so blessed to be able to gather together. And now for our kids' message. Today we're going to tell you a Christmas story, or the Christmas story. And we're going to have our kids come on up and gather around. We welcome all of you kids who are here in person, all of you online. We welcome all the kids to gather around. We're going to act out the Christmas story. What's this Christmas story all about? Yes, baby Jesus. It's his birthday. Baby Jesus is in the manger over there, but we're going to act out the whole thing. Now, everything that you just sang about being in a manger. As we read the parts, the kids will act out their parts. This is very spontaneous. This is non-rehearsed. We're going to let the Holy Spirit direct our steps. So kids, as you hear your part being read out loud, go ahead and move around the stage and act out as whatever part you want, okay? And now Hannah will begin our Christmas story.
This is how the birth of Jesus came about. God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary, who was pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The angel went to Mary and said,
"Greetings, you are highly favored. The Lord is with you."
Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her,
"Do not be afraid, Mary, you have found favor with God. You will be the child and give birth to a son. You are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will never end."
"How will this be?"
The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One will be born, be called the Son of God, for nothing is impossible with God.
I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said.
Then the angel left her. Mary had been pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph was a righteous man and considered what he should do. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying,
Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because the baby in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins.
When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife.
In those days, Caesar Augustus made an order that a census should be taken to the entire Roman world, and everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born.
Right on cue.
And she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them at the inn. And they gave him the name Jesus.
Wait, the microphone.
There were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over the flocks of the sheep. At night, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them,
Do not be afraid. Behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloaks and lying in a manger.
Suddenly,
there was a great multitude
of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill toward men.
When the angels
had left them, gone into heaven, and a shepherd said to one another,
let's go to Bethlehem and see this that's happening, which the Lord has told us about.
So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherd said to them. Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem during the time of King Herod, wise men came from the east to Jerusalem and asked,
Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east, and we have come to worship.
When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed. He asked the chief priests and the teachers of the law where the Christ was to be born. And they replied, in Bethlehem in Judea, as it is written by the prophet. Then Herod sent them to Bethlehem. So they went on their way. And behold, the star that they had seen in the east went before them until it stopped over the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they were overjoyed. And when they saw the child with his mother, Mary, they bowed and they worshiped him. Everybody bow and worship the baby Jesus. Then they presented him their treasures. Bring your treasures. The gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their own country another way. Okay, where's Lisa?
That is the Christmas story.
Great. Amen. Great job, kids. All right. Now let's go decorate some gingerbread cookies. Yay. Good job, everybody.
I think my kids in angels' costumes is a little bit of false advertising. But we'll let that go. So I suppose there are two overarching questions about Christmas. The first is, how did it happen? How did Jesus come to earth? And for that, we have prophecy. We have two stories, one in Matthew and one in Luke. God became flesh, the incarnation. God took on a body, became a physical being. The second question is why? Why did the Son of God come to earth? Why did God become a physical being? And the answer is reconciliation. Hark, the Herald Angels Sing has a line at the end that Charles Wesley used to sum it all up. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. That's the reason for Christmas. That's the purpose. We're in Colossians again. This morning. This is Colossians 1:19-23. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you wholly in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. If you continue in your faith, established and firm, not moved from the hope held out in the gospel. This is the gospel that you heard and has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant. Let me pray for us. Jesus, thank you for this morning and the kids and the choir. Ask your blessing on all this, that your name would be lifted up and glorified. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we've been looking at Jesus through this Advent season. Remember, Christmas and Easter, Christmas is about who Jesus was, and Easter is about what Jesus did. And we're reminded that Christmas is about a real person, a real baby, not a mirage, not an idea, not a philosophy, but a baby born to a peasant couple in ancient Israel. The baby was born to reconcile sinners to God, as it says in verse 22. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. See, humanity was in this weird relationship with God. God was holy, and he is holy, and we were not and are not. He had given us all these rules to live by, and we broke them thoroughly, consistently. And so we had this weird, stunted, bruised relationship with God. We had, honestly, an unreconciled relationship with God. And I completely get that this is not the normal way to explain Christmas to people. My sister bought me a long time ago on a song on a record. And for those of you who are younger, a record is a big black plastic thing. Then when you put it on a record player and you put the needle down, somehow the grooves in there made music come out the speakers. I'm not clear on all that, but she bought me this record called We Are the World, which was a fundraising effort by musicians to help folks who were struggling in Africa. So good purpose. But the song contained the line, "We are the world, we are the children, we are the ones to make a brighter day, so let's start giving." And then there were some other ones. Let me, 1 second. I had it here this morning, I was looking it up. because the really problematic line is here. There's a choice we're making. We're saving our own lives. It's true we'll make a better day, just you and me. And so that was kind of a problem for me. First, the problem with that song is I always want to know how much celebrities are actually giving to this fundraising drive. If they're asking me to give, I want to know how much they're giving. I can't have them just guilting me while they're giving nothing. So that just always bothered me. The other thing, in the lyrics, you heard that. It implies that we can save ourselves. Bob Dylan was one of the guys recording it. And during the press junket that they were in, he looked really uncomfortable. And one of the people asked him, one of the journalists said, why do you look so uncomfortable? What's going on? And he said, I'll tell you why. He says, because man cannot save himself. Bob Dylan understands the true meaning of Christmas. Jesus came because we can't save ourselves. We couldn't save ourselves, and that was the problem. It was the problem that Jesus came to take care of. This little passage is about reconciliation, the need to reconcile with God, the way that happens, and the results. So Paul says he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. So Paul explains the situation, as he sometimes does, using the Old Testament. See, he's referring to the Old Testament ritual at the temple where you became cleansed from sin. You might remember that a person had to bring a perfect animal sacrifice, often a dove or a lamb, as part of that ritual to cleanse someone from sin. That was the way that God gave his people to be cleansed from sin. Something had to die because the offense of sin is so great against God. But not only that, but people were supposed to come to the temple in Jerusalem to make the sacrifice clean, a clean body, clean clothes of a particular fabric, no diseases, following the dietary laws, clean. And you might guess that that was very difficult to accomplish in those days. And what God was pointing out to them was that there was something spiritually wrong with them. I mean, to try and follow all these rules is to become aware that it is impossible to approach God in the right way. The ancient Jews had almost no chance to be totally clean. Same with us. We, like them, are continually getting into a position where we are unfit spiritually before God. We are unreconciled, unholy, unworthy to approach God. You just knew that everyone was unworthy to approach God. Some now these days, though, would say we know God better now, that he is a God of love. He's not angry ever. He's not worried about holiness. I think Paul would disagree. He would say the rituals at the temple pointed to a reality, an unchanged spiritual reality, that in and of ourselves, we are unworthy to approach God. And to illustrate this, let me talk about human laws for just a second. Why do we have human laws? So we can live at peace with one another. What is the content, basically, of human laws? Well, basically, to treat other human beings as nothing less than what we are. And if we fail to follow these sorts of laws, there will be no peace. What are the consequences of breaking human laws? Well, if someone breaks into your house or robs a department store, they can't just go before a judge and say, gosh, oops, sorry, my bad. That wouldn't be good enough for a judge, and it wouldn't be good enough for us. And so that lawbreaker is unreconciled to the community. They have incurred a debt, and until the debt is paid, they will not have the privileges of citizenship. They are unclean. They are unreconciled until their debt is paid, whether through prison or fines or work detail or whatever it is. So let's transfer this idea to God's law. What does the Bible say the purpose is for divine law so we can be at peace with God? What is the content of God's law? Well, it's to treat God as nothing less than what he is, to love him with all your heart and your soul and your mind and your strength. Why? If he is our creator, that is simply what loving him and treating him as he is looks like. It's not treating him as any less than he is. So what are the consequences then for refusing to follow God's law? When we decide that our will is going to be the highest law that we follow, when we're acting as our own creator, we break the law. And it isn't about individual rules. It's really the problem at the core of all of our issues. When we demote God from being the king down and we raise ourselves up over him, we can't just say, oops, sorry about that, my bad. Now, for people who understand God to be only loving, sort of, I guess that's appropriate, but I just don't think that's a biblical image of God as he's revealed himself to us through the scripture. See, ultimately, people who believe God only loves, don't believe God, would say that there's a debt that needs to be paid. And what that means is that we actually take our human laws more seriously than we take God's laws. Because we're refusing to treat God with the same consideration that we demand to be treated with. Remember, when human laws are broken, the person is unreconciled until the debt is paid. Otherwise, society breaks down. But it's more serious with God. If there is a personal creator God, transcendent, a God to whom we owe everything, then our debt is an infinite debt. It's common sense. We owe a debt to God that we cannot make right. We're unclean, we're unreconciled, we're unholy and blemished by what we have said and done. Is there a way to be reconciled? Again, Paul is not talking specifically about temple rituals, but they're in the background. And what he says is in verse 2 that Jesus has reconciled you to, rather, God has reconciled you to Christ's physical body through his death. But just a couple verses earlier, Paul says, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood, right? Remember, in the Old Testament, you not only had to be totally clean in every way, physically, but you also needed a perfect sacrifice. In the Old Testament, in Leviticus, a person working to atone for their sins had to physically lay their hands on that animal. Touch was the thing that transferred your sins onto that animal and transferred that animal's perfection onto you. It's not something you could have someone go do for you at the temple. You couldn't just send somebody with some money and say, take care of my sins. Didn't work that way. It was very personal. You had to do that. You had to put your hands on the animal. And then the animal's perfection became your perfection, and your sins became its sins, which sounds exactly like what Jesus does for us, that he takes the punishment for our sins and offers us his perfection in return when we ask him to rule our lives. Jesus takes on our sins and the punishment we deserve, and we get back his perfection that we do not deserve. I'm actually reminded of an event in Jesus' life when there's this one time when Jesus is in a crowd and he's being followed by this woman who has a flow of blood. I don't know if you remember this. And she reaches out in the midst of the crowd and touches Jesus. And he feels power go out from him. And he turns around and says, wait a minute, someone touched me. Who touched me? And all the disciples said, you got to be kidding me. There's all these people around here. What do you mean, who touched you? Everyone's touching you. That woman, because of that flow of blood, she was not clean. She was not able to go to the temple. She was not able to atone for her sins. She hadn't been able to do anything religiously. She was exiled from God because of that flow. She shouldn't have even touched the rabbi because her touching him makes him unclean. And she did it anyway. This woman was longing to get right with God, but she's unable to do it in and of herself. While the Pharisees thought that they were close to God by doing all the right things in and of themselves, and it turns out they really weren't. She knew she was unfit but was seeking God, and the Pharisees were just the opposite. They thought they were fit and they weren't seeking God, content that they knew God and he was cool with them, when that wasn't the case at all. You know, there are other examples of warnings in the Old Testament that the unholy should not touch the holy. I don't know if you remember when when Moses goes up on the mountain, he says, don't anybody touch this mountain. I mean, even goats, don't graze on this mountain because everything will die. Remember poor Uzziah. They're transporting the Ark of the Covenant, and it's on a cart, and it looks like the Ark is going to fall off the Covenant, and he reaches out and to steady the Ark of the Covenant, and he just dies. He touched something holy, and he was unholy, died as a result. But this woman, her uncleanness went to Jesus, and he took it, and she was made clean. That's what it means to be a Christian, a follower of Jesus. Jesus dies so that we could live. Paul says that what it means to be a Christian now is to be holy and without blemish and without any accusation in his sight. Note the word now. After the cross, after Jesus, now, he writes, now you are presentable. The exchange is real. But now it represents what's happened for us. Jesus represents you before the Father. He has atoned for you. And so the results of this are both individual and cosmic. I mean, the individual we've talked about, that you're unblemished, you're free from accusation. I mean, if you spend any time thinking about this, there should be this joy and this confidence in your life that nothing can put a damper on. I mean, think about this, holy in his sight without blemish. I mean, I think that means we're beautiful to God. You know how your heart feels so good when you think of your kids or your grandkids, how you look out at God's creation from a particular vantage point and it's just breathtaking? When we are in Christ, when he is our Savior, that's how God feels about you and me. He finds you beautiful. It's astonishing. No other religion can come close to this sentiment. Some critics might even say, hey, that's too good to be true. I guess I can respect that. But if someone says Christianity is terrible, they truly don't understand it. Holy and blameless, God finds us worthy, and he's proud of us. Last week, I did a sermon for the Anuri youth about the women in Matthew's genealogy. There's some really interesting women there. Tamar. I don't know if you remember Tamar's story, but she her husband died and didn't give her a baby. His brother was supposed to give her a baby, and he refused to do it. And finally, she just had, enticed her father-in-law to sleep with her, and she had a baby as a result of that. And that baby is a part of Joseph's line. There was Rahab, who is a foreigner in the land. She helped the spies as they're coming into Jericho. She was a prostitute, too, married into the line that produced Joseph. Ruth was a pagan from Moab. And then Bathsheba, who sinned with King David. And Matthew is still so ashamed of her, he's not even able to mention her name. He just says the wife of Uriah. Why are these women mentioned? Because Matthew wants us all to know that because of Jesus, because of God, even people like them are a part of the kingdom. Even people like him, a former tax collector. God's grace and love in Christ are big enough for those folks, and they're big enough in your life too. You can be reconciled to God through Jesus. That's Christmas and Easter. This life that Jesus led, including the cross, was love and justice all wrapped together. It was just because sin was punished, and it was love because the person punished wasn't you. God holds everything together, even as it threatens to pull apart. Sink into the joy of Christmas again this year. I'm so thankful for the choir and Jamie leading us again with music to remind us of God's gift. Peace on earth. And mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. That's what Christmas is about. It's the start of God making a way to bring his wayward creation back to himself. And that's very good news. Every time we hear it. Let's go into a time of prayer and confession. Heavenly Father, we are grateful that you are a God of grace and mercy and love. We depend on it. That you have made a way for us to be cleansed again. All you've asked in return is for us just to come and say it out to you, just to admit it. And so, Lord, Hear our confessions. Hear our prayers. Heavenly Father, you know us so well, better than we know ourselves. We are grateful that you have come to us. We are grateful that you died on the cross for us. We are grateful that you take our sins and offer us your perfection. We are truly sorry for the things that we have done and said that are not your ways. When we took a look at your rules for living and said, no, we know better. We're sorry for that. We apologize and we claim Jesus' blood for that. And we claim the joy of Christmas and Easter morning as well. That would be ours too. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your love. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The good news, of course, of the gospel is not that we are perfect people. We are not. But through Christ, we are forgiven people. And that is the good news of the gospel. And I'll tell you again, you are forgiven. And that is good news. Amen.
You to stand as we close with joy to the world.
1 second before we sing that.
On behalf of the choir and praise group, we do want to give Jamie.
Yay.
Yes. Thank you so much for having me. James, this is for you.
Jesus, it brings us joy. It's a time of celebration. It's just the start of God's plan. And joy to the world really resounds, come Jesus again. And that's what we sing, Jesus as King, joy to the world. So let's begin.
Benediction. There's tons of good stuff over there, as always. So grateful for our fellowship crew. Anyway, so those of you who haven't joined us before, through those doors over there is sugar and caffeine and hydrogenated fats, which I think are the good ones. So that's excellent. Anyway, let me send us out. Lord, we have come today and heard and sung and experienced you again. Send us out with the joy of knowing that you are God who loves us, who knows us, who sacrificed himself for us so that we could live in you. Lord, send us out with that hope. send us out with that peace, that joy, and that love. And the people of God say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.